Welcome to Moco's Most Famous, Montgomery Community Media's latest podcast. We are coming to you from our podcast studio in Rockville, Maryland. My name is Joe Yasharoff. I'm the Director of Content and Operations here at MCM, and I am very excited to be hosting a podcast, and I'm even more excited to be talking to our very special guest today, John Feinstein. You all know who he is, best-selling author, sports writer extraordinaire, columnist, star of TV, radio, and every other medium possible. Welcome to the show, John.
Joe, it's always a pleasure to talk to you in any context.
Well, I appreciate that, and I really appreciate you taking time during your busiest time of, or what I imagine is your busiest time of year with college hoops and golf and everything else that's going on, so thank you for giving us some time today. I just saw on Twitter a report that Frank Robinson has died, and I know you've had many experiences with him, and I wanted to get your reaction as we're just finding out about the great Frank Robinson passing away.
Well, I think my first reaction is more as a fan than a reporter, because I'm old enough, barely, but old enough to remember the 66 Orioles and remember his extraordinary Triple Crown year, not in any detail, but I do remember them sweeping the Dodgers in the World Series, winning the games 3 and 4, 1-0. And of course, I think most fans of baseball who remember would say that the Frank Robinson for Milt Pappas trade was arguably the best trade in the history of baseball for the team that got Robinson, the Orioles, and the worst trade in the history of baseball for the team that got Pappas, even though he's a pretty good pitcher, the Reds. So I remember how, I'm not old enough really to remember him as a Red, but I remember him as an Oriole. And of course, he's an important part of history because he was the first African-American manager in 1974 in Cleveland. He was actually a player manager initially and went on to manage the Orioles and then later the Washington Nationals in their first year here in Washington. And people often forget that that team was picked to lose 100 games and was in first place in July and ended up finishing 81-81. And Frank really did a lot to bring baseball back to the community, to bring the community back to baseball, not only with the play of the team, but with who he was as a spokesman, as somebody who was out there trying to drum up interest in baseball in Washington after it had been away for 33 years. And as a reporter, Frank would always tell you the truth. He didn't mince words. He told you what was good. He told you what was bad. But I have to tell you that one of my first experiences with him was at the baseball winter meetings in 1991. I was starting research on what became my first baseball book, Play Ball. And each team had a hotel suite, and the local reporters would be invited up there every afternoon to get an update from the general manager. And Roland Heeman was the general manager. And Frank was the manager. And so I went up with the Baltimore writers to see Roland and Frank and talk to Oriole people who I knew, obviously. Again, we didn't have a team in Washington, so I'd spent a fair amount of time at that point at Old Memorial Stadium in Baltimore. The next year, they moved into Camden Yards. But I was standing talking to somebody in the room, and I was standing in front of the television set and didn't realize it. And Frank, who was sitting on the couch, says, "Hey, John, could you move out of the way so I can watch the game? There was a basketball game on." "Oh, okay, sure, Frank, anything." And as we're walking out, I said to several of my friends, "Wow, that's kind of cool. Frank knew who I was. I just barely met him a few days ago." And Mark Maskey, my friend from the Washington Post, said, "He asked me what your name was." So it wasn't quite as cool as I thought. But obviously very sad, Frank passing away. But his impact on baseball in so many ways is almost incalculable.
Agreed. Great, great player, but beyond that, just a great man and a great legacy. So sad to hear that minutes ago. All right, so I want to turn to the Wizards, the upheaval that
Why?
Is the Wizards. Why? Well, I think your former colleague...
You're a masochist, I guess.
I am a masochist. Your former colleague at the Post, Tony Kornheiser, might call this the continuation of the curse of Les Boulets. So first this week, we hear about John Wall slipping and falling, and that he's going to be out at least 12 months, which means most probably all of next year. And then last night, kind of a stunner. Otto Porter traded. Markieff Morris. Have they given up, or are they still trying to make the playoffs? What should they do?
Well, I think the trade was something of throwing up a white flag and saying, okay, regardless of whether we can sneak into the playoffs, I mean, for all of Ted Leonsis' talk about, you know, we don't tank and all that, you have to think about your future. I mean, even if they sneaked into the playoffs as the eighth seed and, you know, with 39-43 record or something like that, which will probably get you into the playoffs in the East, So they play Milwaukee, they lose in four. What's gained? Nothing. All you've gained is losing a lottery spot. So I think it's not so much tanking as saying, okay, we understand that our future is not now. And Wall was already out for the season before this latest news on the Achilles, but now they're looking at, okay, we're probably going to have to rebuild. We're stuck with Wall on a Supermax contract for, I think it's what, $170 million. So it's about $42.5 million a year for 4 years. I don't know why they signed him to that contract last year, all right? Because I have been vocal and been criticized for it as not being the biggest John Wall fan. I recognize that he's a talent. He's always had wonderful numbers, but he reminds me a little bit of his former Kentucky teammate, DeMarcus Cousins, who always puts up great numbers and makes spectacular plays. And Cousins has never played in an NBA playoff game. Last year, when Oklahoma City made the second round, it was after he tore, ironically enough, his Achilles and was out for a year. And Wall, of course, has done better than that. The Wizards have won a total of 3 playoff series in his 8 seasons in the league, never been past the second round. And yet people in Washington act as if he's Steph Curry, probably because he keeps insisting he's as good as Steph Curry, which he's not. But Wall, in all likelihood, will be either 30 or almost 30 when he comes back, depending, again, as you said, whether he can play at all next season or not. You never know how much explosiveness you're going to lose with an Achilles injury like that. And Wall's ability to explode into the lane has always been the key to his success. So I think the Wizards are stuck. They can't get rid of Wall. Nobody would touch him now, especially nobody would touch him before this with that contract. They've got one true all-star in Bradley Beal. I think they're probably looking at it was a salary dump to get rid of Porter, who they had signed to a max contract a couple summers ago. They get back Jabari Parker, who's been nothing but a bust in the NBA. When he's not hurt, he's a marginally decent offensive player who can't guard you or me. And the other kid apparently has some potential, but will be a restricted free agent this summer. And do you want to spend, you know, money on him, the kind of money you probably have to spend on him to keep him in Washington? So it's basically a salary dump, but a salary dump at this point isn't necessarily a mistake,
right?
Because they're stuck with the Wall salary, and with salary cap, they got to figure out where they can fit in some good players.
The picture you paint is not pretty. Is there a team that's in worse shape than the Wizards for the next 2 or 3 years? It doesn't look like.
Well, maybe the Knicks.
Ah, there you go.
And they just traded their best player,
right,
Kristaps Porzingis, who's been hurt all year and isn't likely to play this year. But that, you know, they're dumping salary too, and looking to basically start from scratch. The difference is that the one advantage the Knicks have is they don't have anybody with a supermax contract to deal with.
Right. Okay. Well, this is depressing. So let's talk about the Caps. Wait a minute. That's depressing too, because they've lost, I think, what, 7 in a row and 8 of 9. Are you concerned?
Well, they won their last game. They've right. now lost 8 of 10. Not been playing great, but I don't find the Caps situation depressing.
You don't? Okay.
Because they're a veteran team, just as we used to talk in the past before last year, when the Caps would play well in the regular season, when they won the East or they won the President's Trophy. This is not a team that the regular season matters to. They are playing to win Stanley Cups, and they won one last year. It doesn't really matter where you're seated in the NHL. Home ice is not that big a deal. Now, would you prefer to play a Game 7 at home? Yeah. But how have the Caps done historically in Game 7s at home through the years?
Not well.
And I don't think their seeding matters that much. They're probably going to have to go through the Penguins at some point, because the Penguins aren't playing that well either, if they're going to get out of the East. Tampa Bay, I think, is the number one threat. They're, I think, something like 10 points ahead of everybody else, and they're very good. But I don't think, unless they fall into a position where they're out of playoff position, which they're not, they're very much solidly inside those top 8 teams, I don't think you worry about the Caps that much. At least I don't. I think when mid-April rolls around, the important thing is that they're healthy. It doesn't matter where they're seated. They'll get their act together. They're too good not to.
And then you're, I'm sure, giddy about your boyhood team, the Islanders, who have the Caps coach, Barry Trotz, doing pretty well there. How did that happen?
He's done an amazing job. Lou Lamoriello came in as a general manager last spring, made some moves that get, you know, probably got one paragraph of attention, but have really helped bolster the team. He signed Robin Leonard center as a free agent who had, you know, been in Buffalo and had all sorts of personal issues with addiction to drugs and all sorts of problems. But Leonard's been brilliant. He's recovered or recovering, to be accurate, and has played superbly. And they lost John Tavares. They didn't make the playoffs last year. They lose one of the three best players in the NHL, and they're better.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because of some of the moves that Lou Lamoriello's made, and because they've got one of the best coaches in history behind the bench in Barry Trotz. And yeah, I'm thrilled.
All right, so I'm going to bounce around to a couple of things. So our favorite subject, your favorite subject, the Skins, as I call them. We don't have months to discuss this, but here's my one question. Will it ever get better unless the ownership and the president change? Kind of a leading question, but the obvious question.
Well, the only way it will ever get better with the current owner is if he someday realizes that he doesn't know boo about football, to use the kindest word I can think mm-hmm. of, and is willing to do what Steve Bisciotti does in Baltimore, to hire the best possible football person he can find to run the franchise, not a guy like Bruce Allen, who's nothing but an alumni cheerleader and who is Snyder's yes man. That's why he still has a job,
right?
Because Dan likes to be surrounded by yes men who tell him that he's really the good guy and all of us who criticize him are the bad guys. And what any owner needs to do is hire the best possible football person he can hire and do what Bisciotti has done for years, what he did with Ozzie Newsome, what I assume he will continue to do with Eric DaCosta, which is say this, and this is literally what he says to his general managers. If you're going to make a big move, please let me know about it before it happens so I don't hear about it from my friends.
Right.
And not come to me for approval. Now, if they're going to sign someone to a huge contract, obviously you need the owner to approve it. But if Ozzie Newsome or now Eric DaCosta walks in and says, this is what we should do, this is the best thing for our football team, Bisciotti's going to do it. Snyder's never been that way. I mean, Snyder's got to have control. He's got to make all the big decisions. And so you got a guy like Doug Williams there, who I think knows NFL personnel as well as anybody. But Doug is hamstrung and can't make moves without Snyder's approval. When they had a real general manager in place for 2 years,
right,
they drafted well and they got better. And then they decided, you know, Bruce Allen and Dan didn't like the fact that he was getting so much credit. So they fired him and then said terrible things about him publicly, whether true or not, to undermine somebody that way for any reason at all is disgusting.
Well, a game that the Skins used to take part in on a regular basis was the Super Bowl. I'm sure you watched that.
A long time ago, Joe.
A long time ago. You and I are both old.
It doesn't seem like that long ago, but it's been 27 years.
Yes, a long time ago. So Bill Belichick, who I know you know,
mm-hmm.
I think there's really isn't much of an argument now on if he's the greatest coach in NFL history. I think the better question is he the greatest coach, period, in North American sports history?
Yeah, I think it's really hard to make those kind of comparisons. Mm-hmm. I think it's hard to compare eras. You know, is Belichick better than Vince Lombardi? Lombardi won 5 championships in 9 years. There were fewer teams back then. I mean, he was in the NFL when the NFL was still a 14-team league. And then he when the Super Bowl started those first 2 years, you added the 10 AFL teams. Now there are 32 teams. Now you have to win a minimum of 3 games to win the Super Bowl, sometimes 4. In those days, when Lombardi won his first 3 NFL titles, there was only 1 postseason game to win. And then when he won the 2 Super Bowls, he only had to win 2. So, but I'm not trying to take anything away from Lombardi. I'm just saying it was a different time. Just like when John Wooden won his 10 national titles at UCLA, for 9 of those, he only had to win 4 games. And for the last one, he won 5 games.
Right.
But in single elimination, when you win that many, 10 and 12 years in Wooden's case, that's spectacular.
That is hard to argue.
Yeah, so you Wooden, Red Auerbach,
mm-hmm.
who won 9 titles in 10 years with the Celtics and 11 out of 13 when he became the general manager total. Red Auerbach, Lombardi, John Wooden. I think all of Casey Stengel won 10 American League pennants and I think 7 or 8 World Series titles in 12 years. All those people have to be in the conversation. But if we're going to have a debate and you give me Belichick, I'm perfectly happy. I can make the argument Belichick's the best.
Sure.
If you give me Wooden, I'm happy too. But I think you can definitely make the argument for Belichick.
Great stuff from John Feinstein. We're going to step away for a moment, and when we come back, we're going to talk college hoops with John Feinstein. You're listening to Moco's Most Famous, and I'm Joe Yasharoff.
MCM, your community media center, is making Montgomery County a great place to live through programs like 21 This Week. Montgomery County's hardest-hitting political talk show keeps you up to date with the local political scene. Montgomery Community Media. Our middle name is Community.
We are back. I'm Joe Yasharoff. This is Moco's Most Famous. Our guest is best-selling author John Feinstein, who joins us on the phone. John, I want to talk to you about Montgomery County. The show title is Moco's Most Famous. You're in Moco, Montgomery County. You've been here for a good portion of your life. I know you're a New Yorker, and once a New Yorker, always a New Yorker. But why Montgomery County? What do you like about Montgomery County?
Well, it's kind of ironic, Joe, because when I was getting married for the first time in 1988 and my wife and I were looking for a place to live, we looked in Virginia, we looked in the district, we looked in Maryland. And the one house we found that my then wife, Mary, loved was in Avenel, which was a brand new development at the time. And I liked the idea because it was, you know, part of a golf course community. And back then I played a lot of golf. But the other reason, what kind of finished the deal for us was great schools. And, you know, we were planning to have children. So why not live in a house we liked in a county that has great public schools? We were both public school kids. Turned out each of the two children we had together had learning issues. And so I had to go to private school. Hmm. Although my son, Danny, who was ADD, and his issues weren't nearly my daughter, Bridget, had ADHD and had more serious issues, but went to McLean School and did great there. But Danny ended up graduating from Churchill High School after he'd been in private school. We moved him to Churchill and he did great there. And I will always be grateful to the people at Churchill for the work they did with Danny. So schools had a big role in our moving to Montgomery County. And then my daughter, Bridget, who I mentioned, she was a non-sleeper. She was hyperactive. And so my wife and I would take turns driving her around in the car because that was the only way to get her to fall asleep. And in driving around, you know, in our neighborhoods, I drifted through Potomac Falls and thought, wow, this would be a great place to live someday. And eventually we bought a house in Potomac Falls and I still live in that house. And now I'm remarried. I have an 8-year-old daughter who's brilliant, Joe. So the plan is for her to go to public schools as she gets older. And it's been, you know, Potomac Village is a wonderful little place that you feel like you're living in a small town, even though you're 20 minutes from the nation's capital or an hour, depending on the time of day. And we're very, very happy living here.
I expect that your daughter will be going to Duke. I expect to hear that announcement in about 10 years.
She better not go to Duke. She better go to a place a lot better than Duke.
Okay. Where,
you know, I'm targeting Harvard, but we'll settle for Yale.
Okay. Nice, nice. All right, well, I brought up Duke, so let's talk about Duke. So clearly one of the best teams in the country, as always, with Coach K. The talent is indisputable. Zion Williamson, I wanted to ask you where you stood on him is, and, you know, he's in college now, and that's what we're worried about, but a lot of folks question whether he is going to be great in the NBA because he's not necessarily a great shooter.
I don't think you have to be a great shooter to be a great player in the NBA.
Mm-hmm.
I also think that a lot of players come into the NBA as not great shooters and evolve into great shooters. Magic Johnson certainly did that.
Yep.
Others have evolved different parts of their game as they get older in the league. I think a lot of it depends on your approach. I don't know Zion Williamson. From what I've read, from what I've heard, he's someone who's going to want to work to get better. He's not just going to be satisfied being a multimillionaire, which he certainly will be next year. You might have heard Dick Vitale mention that once or a million times during the course of the season. But, you know, he's a different kind of talent because he's so big and so quick. And you don't see that combination very often. I am, like a lot of people, awfully tired of seeing Zion Williamson highlight.
Yep.
It's not that he's not an outstanding player, but it seems as if, it's not just that Duke's the only team ESPN pays attention to. It seems as if he's the only player they pay attention to, and the only thing they ever show him doing is dunking.
True.
And a friend of mine called me back in January, and it was right after Duke had played Clemson at home. And he said, if you want to know why people hate Duke, watch that telecast. And so I did. And I understood what he was saying. ESPN and Vital was doing the game, and he's not the only one guilty of this. He's just the most guilty. And I like Dick personally very much, by the way. But they treated Clemson like they were the Washington Generals. I mean, I was expecting the water bucket trick to come along any minute. And Clemson's a pretty good team. And Duke ended up pulling away and winning. But the point is, with the screaming and the yelling and the, you know, Zion Williamson's the greatest this, the greatest that, I could see why people would get sick of it. And it's not the kids' fault.
Right.
And it's not Duke's fault. But it's the way today's media is. They latch on to something or someone, and they just don't want to let go.
All right, so we got to go do a little bit of a lightning round here so we can get to a few topics in our remaining time. Maryland basketball seems to be on the resurgence. There was a hiccup there with Illinois, which was a pretty big hiccup. Are you a believer? Are you not a believer? Are you somewhere in between on Maryland?
Well, it depends what your definition is of a believer. I think they're going to be in the tournament, which is certainly an improvement on last year. It is not a coincidence to me that the only 3 years Maryland's been in the tournament since Mark Turgeon arrived were the 3 years that Melo Trimble was there. Mm-hmm. He was a great college player. But Mark's got a very solid team this year. And as he keeps pointing out, they're very young. But there's no such thing as a young team anymore.
That's true.
There's a good chance they'll lose Bruno to the draft next year. There's a chance to lose Cowan. There's a chance to lose Smith. I mean, that's the way college basketball is. So you just don't know. You know, people talk about building. Okay, let's get in the tournament this year, get to the Sweet 16, and then we'll be even better next year. It's not guaranteed. But Maryland's a very solid team. I think they're one of the five Big Ten teams that right now would be locks to get a bid. And the Illinois loss was a bad loss, but I'll point out Michigan State lost to them the other night, too.
True. All right, Georgetown, I was not a believer that they were moving in the right direction before the season started. I've seen some of their games. They haven't won all of the close games, but it seems like they are at least moving in the right direction.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, I don't think the Big East is very good this year. Mm-hmm. The fact that a Villanova team that lost four players to the NBA is 10-0 and on top of the league, I think, is partly a reflection of what a good coach Jay Wright is, but it's also a reflection of the fact that the Big East isn't nearly as good this year as it has been. Xavier, which was a team that was contending for number one seed for the last 3 or 4 years, is way down. Butler's just okay. Creighton's just okay. Georgetown's just okay. St. John's has improved to just okay. There's a lot of just okay teams in that league.
Right.
So Georgetown, I think, has had opportunities to make some hay. I think Patrick Ewing's got a good freshman class, and it's a good freshman class in the sense that I don't see any of their kids turning pro unless they make a terrible mistake. So they could be, should be better next year, even though they'll lose Govan. But yeah, I guess you could say they're moving in the right direction, but I don't think they're moving in it all that quickly.
All right, UVA, we know they're a great team. We know what happened last year.
They're going in the right direction.
Yeah, they're definitely going in the right direction, although last year didn't end in a very good direction.
No.
My question is, can they win a championship, forget Final Four, can they win it all with that style of basketball?
100% they can. 100% they can. What happened in that UMBC game was a complete outlier. Mm-hmm. And not just because of 16-1, but I saw UMBC a lot last year because I do their games, home games on television. And they had two senior guards that were as good as any in the country, as any in the country. Not in terms of pro potential, but as college guards. Mm-hmm. KJ Mora was exactly the kind of point guard you do not want to play against. He is great on the ball defender. He was very smart at both ends of the court. I'm not sure. I watched him play for 2 years. I'm not sure I ever saw him take a bad shot.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Jarris Lyles would take a bad shot, but he was also one of the great streak shooters, particularly his senior year, that you'll see in college basketball. And they got on a roll early, built some confidence that they could play with Virginia. And I think Virginia went into shock in the second half.
Right.
I mean, it's not like the game was close. It wasn't.
No.
So I see that game as an outlier. I you know, I know people say, oh, Tony Bennett's style makes for close games. Sure it does, but they win most of them.
Right.
So does that guarantee a championship? No. But if you're asking me if they can win a championship, absolutely, I think they can win a championship.
All right, let's talk about your books. I think I own and have read all of them, maybe not all of the mysteries. Forgive me for that. Season on the Brink, Civil War, the Ryder Cup book, which was great. I know I was bugging you after the Ryder Cup. When's the book going to be done? When's the book going to be done? So I'm sorry about that.
It's
but it
done,
was,
Joe.
It was worth the wait. Let's talk about your book, Quarterback. And if you could tell us what the gist of the book is, obviously it's about quarterbacks, but tell us a little more.
The book is called Quarterback. And the five guys, the main guys I worked with, I mean, I talked to, I don't know how many quarterbacks, but the five main guys I worked with were Joe Flacco, Alex Smith, Andrew Luck, Ryan Fitzpatrick, and Doug Williams. Now, are those the five best quarterbacks in the NFL? No, I wasn't looking for the five best. I was looking for five guys who were willing and able to give me insight into what it's like to playing the position. And by say willing, I mean in terms of time and in terms of being willing to be honest and open with me, which I think they, each of the five were. All the common thread besides that among the five is they're all real smart. I mean, you know Ryan Fitzpatrick's smart because he graduated from Harvard with a degree in economics. But the other four are all very bright guys. People miss with Doug Williams, I think, how smart he is sometimes because he's got that big Louisiana accent. Mm-hmm. But he's as smart as anybody I've met in pro sports. And I asked Doug, who was the one non-active quarterback, to be in the book because I needed an African-American voice. And I needed somebody who knew the history of how far African-American quarterbacks have had to come to gain acceptance. And to this day, I think it's still a battle. I mean, look at last year when people were saying Lamar Jackson should become a wide receiver. Would anybody have ever said that about a white quarterback with the same skills? I don't think so. And look how he played as a quarterback, going as the fifth quarterback chosen, 22 picks after the fourth quarterback chosen. And he probably had the best year of any of the rookies, first round rookies in the league playing quarterback. So Doug was really great talking about what it was like living in a southern city as a starting quarterback in the late 1970s in Tampa. And you may or may not be aware of this, but he credits much of his success to Joe Gibbs, mm-hmm. who was a Tampa Bay assistant coach when Doug was at Grambling and who was the guy who convinced John McKay to make Doug the first African-American quarterback drafted in the first round, 17th pick, and was very much his mentor and tutor early on. And, of course, was the guy who brought him here to Washington, where he became the first African-American quarterback to start and win a Super Bowl.
Well, I'm going to stop rereading the Ryder Cup book and go out and get quarterback.
I hope you won't be alone.
I hope I won't be there. I trust that I will not be. John, really enjoyed your insight and your time, especially during this busy time. I wanted to thank a few people besides John, executive producer Gaynell Evans, engineer Mike Valentine, and everyone at Montgomery Community Media. John, next time we talk, I want to talk about how pizza and bagels are not necessarily always better when they're from New York. What do you think about that?
You'd be mistaken. Although Regina's Pizza in Boston is very good.
Okay, but nothing in Montgomery County or in Maryland can compete?
No, can't compete. No, absolutely not. John's Pizza in New York is the best. Regina's is the second best. Now, Potomac Pizza is pretty good. It's pretty good. It's not as good as those two, but it's pretty good.
And I know that, and we're running out of time, but I know that Vincent Dominic's, which RIP Vincent Dominic's, you were not a big fan of. I tried to make
you
a believer.
Not a big fan. Too much cheese. But yeah. I'm different than most people. Most people like more cheese.
Yeah, well.
So I understand why people like you would like Vincent Dominic's, but I prefer like Bertucci's, which I don't think we have one in Montgomery County, but Bertucci's does not put as much cheese in their sauce, and that's my favorite local pizza, even though most of them have closed in this area. The Pennsylvania Avenue one is still open.
We'll do another podcast just on pizza next time. So thank you again, John. Before we go, I wanted to share my favorite memory of Frank Robinson. You know, he won a couple of MVPs. Everybody knows the stats. Great career, great numbers, a lot of home runs, very good manager for a few teams, first African-American manager. Everybody knows that. My favorite memory of Robinson happened 2005, 2006, when he was the manager of the Nats. It was a game against the Astros here in D.C. at RFK Stadium. The Nats catcher, Matt LaCroix, was having an absolutely brutal game behind the plate. Gave up 7 stolen bases, couple of throwing errors. It was as bad a game as you can have as a catcher. So what Robinson did is he pulled him in the middle of an inning, which you almost never see in baseball. It's just not done. But Robinson decided to do it, and some might have thought that was a humiliating move. I thought it was the exact opposite. He was putting LaCroix out of his own misery. You know, enough is enough. And he couldn't bear to watch his player being embarrassed anymore. So after the game, this is the part that really got me. Robinson was doing his regular post-game press conference, and he could not contain his emotions. The man was crying, and this is a man who was known as one of the toughest guys to ever play. He was an intimidating player on the field and even off the field. Very tough guy. Well, the emotions were flying. He barely could get the words out about LaCroix. And it just struck me as so human, so genuine, so real, very paternal. And it turned out, you know, Robinson wasn't such a tough guy after all. And that's all you really need to know about Frank Robinson. That's how I will choose to remember him. And RIP Frank Robinson, just one of the greats in baseball history. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Please spread the word about the podcast. The show is called Moco's Most Famous. I'm Joe Yasharoff. Have a great day.